The Houston Safari Club Foundation Worldwide Hunting Expo and Convention at the George R. Brown Convention Center, February 4th through the 6th, 2022. Hunting and fishing outfitters from around the world. Gear, firearms, optics, taxidermy, and more. Banquets, auctions, raffles, and entertainment. $10 at the door. Children 12 and under and active military with ID get in free. Proceeds support youth education, scholarships, conservation, and hunters' rights. Sponsored by Gunworks, Forlow, Capital Farm Credit, Wildlife Partners, and Boyd's Hardwood Gun Stocks. Go to WeHuntWeGive.org to learn more.
Tradition, conservation, family, the outdoors. It matters to you. It matters to us. This is Hunting Matters, presented by Houston Safari Club Foundation. Here's Joe Bitar.
Good morning. Welcome back to Hunting Matters on KPRC 950. I'm your host, Joe Bitar.
I'm Ramon Robles.
Am I a little hot there?
A little bit, maybe. Yeah. I mean, your wife would say you're always hot.
I don't know about that.
I think. How do I sound? Do I sound better?
You sound good.
Yo.
You sound
good. Just in a new studio this morning just because of things going on here at the radio station. And we're just kind of thrown for a loop. It's just weird to see you in a different light. And,
yeah. I kind of like this feature lighting up here. I'm going to turn that spotlight next time we get in here.
Yeah.
And we got moved to a new studio because we've become so hugely successful.
Get your ego through the door.
That's right.
That's what
we
it was.
Three microphones in this studio.
Actually, I have five.
Five?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. You do have five.
Forgot to silence my phone.
And
I apologize about that.
We've also got the special effects in here.
Oh, my goodness. See, that's why they don't let you in.
So whenever we have a good... Don't leave toys laying around.
Oh, my goodness.
Hey, don't threaten me with a good time, as they say. So what have you been up to this week?
Not a lot going on. You know, it's been raining, which the old man in me is like, oh, thank God I don't have to get out there and mow the yard, you know, because the grass is just still wet.
Right.
So, you know, I guess that's what you got to look forward to, kids, when you get older.
Yeah, that's right. Or you could be the old man in me and go, man, my hip's kind of sore today. What did I do? Oh, yeah, I pulled weeds in the flower bed weekend, and so my back's hurting. So that's ridiculous. Hey, folks, we got a lot of cool stuff coming up with Houston Safari Club Foundation. Go to WeHuntWeGive.org. Check it out. Go to the membership page, and you'll see all kinds of events. In October, we're going to be doing a big sporting clays tournament, which, Ramon, we do every year. And this year now moving forward, is the funds that we raise are going to be dedicated towards our youth education program, taking kids hunting and fishing and all that. So go to WeHuntWeGive.org, sign up for the sporting clays tournament today. It's going to be October 23rd, which is a Saturday. So some people don't like that because they can't play hooky from work and bring clients, and other people like it because they can go. So, and then convention, of course, is coming up next February 4th through the 6th at the George R. Brown Convention Center. So,
man, it's going to happen.
It's going to happen.
Golly.
It's going to happen, and we want people to come out in the masses.
I've never been to one, well, in the time that we've done this show, because
it's been 2 years.
Yeah, they've just
it will have been 2 years.
This will be the third.
Yeah.
I mean, calendar year.
Yeah, 19 was the last time we had a convention, really.
Wow.
Just crazy. Crazy. Anyway, so folks, you're in for a treat today. Our guest I've known for, I hate to even say how many years.
Come on. Let's see.
7, 12, almost 20. Almost 20 years.
Wow.
Almost 20 years. Joining us today is Gary Roberson. Gary is the owner of Burnham Brothers Game Calls, and there's a lot of other stuff that he's involved with we're going to talk about. So, Gary, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning, Joe. Gosh, time flies when you're having fun. It surely can't be 20 years, can it?
Almost. Yeah, almost.
Almost.
So I appreciate you.
And not only that, we've been hunting together on several occasions.
Yep.
Out in West Texas and here around Menard, and I kind of miss those days.
Yeah, I do too, and I'll tell, Ramon does know this, and most, well, all of our listeners don't know this, but Ramon, Gary Roberson is the reason that I had to invest in additional firearms and game calls.
Okay.
Because Gary was the guy who taught me how to call predators.
Mm-hmm.
Gary was also one of the first people to take me ever on a turkey hunt.
Oh, okay.
And Gary, my wife, thanks you for that, and then for those investments that I had to make in all that equipment.
Well, tell Charlotte I said hey.
I will. She asks about you guys all the time. So Gary is a native of Medina County. He's based out of Menard. Gary, you You've been involved in the outdoors for quite a while. Before we get into that, I forgot our meaningless trivia of the week.
Let's get Gary in on this.
Yeah, let's get Gary in on it. So Gary already knows the answer to this, but Ramon, I don't know if you do.
Okay.
So what animal can be found in most of the United States? They can run up to about 40 miles an hour, and they live between 10 and 14 years.
Not deer.
That's all I'm going to tell you. Just get those three clues.
How fast can they run?
Up to 40 miles an hour.
Hippopotamus.
Those are only found in Mexico and South America and Africa.
Oh, I got you.
Depending on if you're a cartel leader and have one on your farm.
I'm going with the coyote.
Gary's right. It's coyote.
Now, what gave it away? I mean, what brought that home for you?
Well, the speed that they can run, but also their ability to live. You know, they're canines, so about the same lifespan as most dogs.
Okay.
But let's face it, you know, this old coyote, you know, somebody's not feeding, you know, putting out kibble for him every day. He's got to go out and make a living.
Yeah.
And that's got to be a little more taxing on your body.
Coyote.
I think Gary told me one time there's going to be two things that are going to be remaining when the apocalypse hits. That's going to be coyotes and cockroaches.
Coyotes, really?
Yeah.
That's true, but, you know, now I've revised it. The coyote's going to be the last one because he'll eat those cockroaches if he has to survive.
Yeah.
He's the ultimate survivor.
Yeah, they'll eat anything. So, Gary, you weren't always involved in the hunting business. Let's go way back. Let's talk a little bit about what you did before you were involved in the hunting industry and game calling.
Well, when I got out of college, I went to work for the Federal Land Bank. And then, of course, that was free, like, capital farm credit. So what we did was make farm and ranch loans around the state of Texas. And in those days, of course, we did everything from taking the application to doing the credit work and doing the appraisal work. So I love the appraisal work most because it gave me an opportunity to get out in the field, you know, and go over ranches. And of course, when you're out there, you know, appraising a ranch, you're seeing wildlife. If I thought there were any Indian artifacts, I might have been looking for those as well. But it was a great life, and kept me in the woods. You know, and in different parts of the state. I was raised in South Texas, but when I went to work for the land bank, I was more in Central Texas, working out of Waco. But then I wasn't there long before I moved and took over another office in Stephenville and then worked on up into Parker, Palapena counties. And then after a couple of years there, I moved over to Madisonville, which I thought was East Texas. And I spent a little while over in East Texas. And after working there for a while, I was really starved to get back out west. And that's kind of when I got into commercial banking and moved to Menard as president of Menard National Bank. So when I moved here in 85, I was bank president. I didn't own Burnham Brothers, but shortly thereafter, of course, Murray Burnham and I was hunted together some, and then I bought him out of Burnham Brothers in 1991.
All right. Okay, folks, Gary, we're going to take a quick break right here. Folks, we'll be back with our guest, Gary Roberson of Burnham Brothers Game Calls, on the other side. Hunting Matters, KPRC 950. Down, and the
flames went higher. Have you heard about the Houston Safari Club Foundation? They're a nonprofit organization that provides annual scholarships to college students, hunting and fishing trips, and outdoor education programs for hundreds of students each year. And they fund conservation projects at home and abroad to protect habitat and wildlife. A community of hunters and people passionate about the outdoors. Monthly events, an annual convention, member benefits, and so much more. Whether you hunt quail in South Texas or big game around the world, this is the place for you. Become a member today. Go to wehuntwegive.org to learn more. wehuntwegive.org.
The first thing I remember knowing was a lonesome whistle blowing, and a youngin's dream of growing up to ride on a freight train leaving town, not knowing where I'm bound, and no one could change my mind, but Mama tried.
Good morning. Welcome back to Hunting Matters on KPRC 950. I'm your host, Joe Bitar.
I'm Ramon Robles.
And we are joined today by Gary Roberson. Gary is the owner. Oh, there we go.
Phone lines are busy on a Saturday for Gary.
Oh, man. Hold on, folks.
He's making it happen.
The all-request line is not open yet. So Ramon's not taking requests yet for music.
Yet.
Anyway, where we were, Gary Roberson is our guest today. Gary is the owner of Burnham Brothers Game Calls. You can learn about them at burnhambrothers.com. That's B-U-R-N-H-A-M brothers.com, burnhambrothers.com. Gary is a writer. Gary is, I'd call him a master of game calling and a great educator. He's taught me a lot of stuff over the years. And Gary also, which we'll talk about in a little bit, Gary is also part of a television show called Carnivore, which has one of the coolest logos in outdoor television on the Pursuit Channel. Gary, thanks so much again for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
You can't get anybody to answer the phones around there?
I can't. In fact, I decided I better move away from it in case it rings again. So I'm getting a little further away from it, so maybe it won't bother us.
There we go. So where we left off before we went to the break, you were talking about you'd made the transition out of the banking industry, and you had met Murray Burnham, and you purchased Burnham Brothers Game Calls in 91. So let's pick up there. Tell us a little bit about that history.
Well, Murray and I hunted together in the late 80s, and about 1990, he mentioned he was thinking about selling the company, and I, to be honest with you, I'd been in the banking business for about 17 years, and I was tired of chasing two-legged coyotes, and was enjoying chasing four-legged ones a little more, so I decided to go on and try to purchase the company, which we did. And it didn't take me long to realize that I couldn't do both. I either had to, you know, get away from the bank or get rid of Burnham Brothers. And I decided to keep Burnham Brothers. So it was for sure financially, if it was the best decision, but I know it was much more fun than banking was back in the 80s and early 90s. So that's what we did. We just went, you know, put our head down and put all of our energy into Burnham Brothers. Away we went. And then, of course, you mentioned the TV show. We started that. We're broadcasting our 11th season right now. And that's kind of hard for me to imagine, because I never really wanted to do TV, but I think you can remember back, we had several sponsors, Mossy Oak and Savage Arms and Nikon Optics that were pushing us to do it. And at that time, there weren't many folks doing predator hunting on TV. So they convinced me we should be doing it. And so since we had built-in sponsors, away we went.
Yeah, and for those who have not ever been involved in outdoor television, exactly to your earlier point is, you know, if you've ever hunted with a camera following along behind you or in front of you or wherever they're positioned, it's not always as much fun as it's cracked up to be. It's really nice to sneak away without a camera sometime. But like you said, I mean, you guys basically had people calling you, chasing you down at SHOT Show and everything else, saying, look, you know, we've hunted with you. We've seen what you can do. You ought to do a television show. And so it kind of, you know, most people do a TV show thinking they're going to get rich and they go out and get sponsors. And you guys were actually, the model was a little bit reversed, because you had people coming to you saying, we'll sponsor you if you'll just do a show.
It was, and that is, you're right, Joe, that's exact opposite of what most folks do. And, of course, since that time, since we started, it's gotten, you know, it's gotten more competitive. There's so many TV shows out there. And, you know, so getting sponsors is a little bit more difficult. And of course, we like to promote our products on the show as well.
Sure.
But we never, when I take on a sponsor, I I tell them I'm not going to be in, this will not be an infomercial. We're going to do the hunt. We're going to try to be cinematic. We're going to try to tell a story, and we will show your products in use, but I'm not going to ever stand there and preach the virtues of a product. I think that turns the viewer off. It's not what I want to see.
Right.
So, but it's been successful. You know, like I say, we're in 11 season right now. And, I don't know, I turned 68. I don't know how many more years I'm going to do this,
right.
The TV show that is, but so far, you know, it's been fun.
Yeah,
but if not fun, I'm going to quit, Joe.
There you go. Well, you know, it's like you made the transition from the banking industry to, you know, over to game calling. I mean, you know, at some point you kind of evaluate your life and go, you know, I actually heard a musician today on a podcast say, you know, as I've gotten to be 70 years old, he said, I have to do these things that I have to do as part of my music career. But, you know, it used to be I'd have four things to do, and I liked actually doing one of them in a day. And he goes, now I'm 70, and I just do the one I enjoy, and the other three can just, you know, kick it to the side.
Yeah. Well, it seems like, you know, here I am 68, but I really have more irons in the fire than ever before. We've got, not only do we, you know, do the TV show and of course, have Burnham Brothers Game Calls and working on a new ultrasonic game call. We also sell a few ranches here.
Yeah.
Just because I love dealing with real estate. And, you know, that's probably not going to change. But, gosh, it seems like we're so busy now, especially in the development of this new caller.
Yeah.
We're doing technology that's never been done before. So, that's crazy. That's going crazy right now. And then, of course, I've never seen real estate going crazier than it is
now. Absolutely.
It's just, I know it is in Houston, but even out here, you know, people are wanting to relocate to rural areas.
Yeah. I mean, I think we've all heard the stories, people showing up at somebody's doorsteps and saying, hey, I want to buy your place, and or buying them on the internet without ever seeing it. You know, they're just snatching up land left and right. Like you said, they're fleeing other states, and they're fleeing the cities, and they're wanting to get out in the country.
I don't mind a few of them coming, but
sure.
Like these folks from California, I don't want them to bring their beliefs here.
Yeah, that's reasonable.
I don't want them to change us to what they left.
Sure.
You know, that's the only problem I see.
Well, maybe we can convert some of them to Texans if they do show up. But you know, here's hoping. So I want to come back to the new things you guys are doing. But Gary, how have you seen game call technology change and advance over the years? We want to kind of talk a little bit about that, and then we're going to jump into a break here.
All righty. Well, of course we built the first digital caller back in 1991.
Yeah.
1990 and 91, we released it right after I bought Burnham Brothers. Murray had already started that project. So that was the first digital caller ever, and that was, we called it the CompuCaller.
Right.
And
I still have one.
You probably still have that one. Then we came out with CompuCaller 2, yep. 3. All of them had... The first one did not operate off a remote.
I think I had a later edition then.
You had a later one. I think you had a two or three.
I had a two or three, absolutely. Well, Gary, hold that thought there. I want to expand on that development phase of the call technology. We're going to take a quick break here on Hunting Matters on KPRC 950.
If he goes, it doesn't matter anymore, 'cause I'm riding. Up from San Antonio, everything that I got is just what I've got on.
Good morning. Welcome back to Hunting Matters on KPRC 950. I'm your host, Joe Bitar.
I'm Ramon Robles.
We're talking today with Gary Roberson of Burnham Brothers Game Calls. Gary, so much.
That's good.
I get my third quarter tongue-tied. Here we go. I don't have enough coffee in my system.
Seriously. Probably the donut you were shoving in your mouth during the break.
Yeah.
Sprained your tongue.
I'm going to have that sugar high in a few minutes. To joining us today, folks, is Gary Roberson. Gary is the owner of Burnham Brothers Game Calls. I have to say that slowly because mm-hmm. that's kind of a tongue twister. Gary, thanks so much for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me, Joe.
So we were talking before we went in the break about the evolution of game calls over the years, and you guys started with the first electronic, the copy caller, and we were talking about the I still have, I guess it's the two or three. I have to go back and look at the number. It doesn't matter to me because it works. But where are you, how else have you seen the call industry and the development of the technology change over the last, you know, so many years?
Back in the 90s, we came out with the copy caller, which was the first digital caller, but I always felt there was something missing. I knew from reading and observing wildlife, especially coyotes, that they were communicating at a frequency that we could not hear, because I had been close enough to observe them and could tell that they were communicating to each other like a dog. When you talk to your dog, it'll sit there, you know, sit and look at you and study you, and it twists his head back and forth as he's trying to figure out what you're trying to tell him, if your dog is very intelligent, that is.
Right.
And a coyote is highly intelligent, by the way. Anyway, I've watched coyotes communicating with each other, and then they would change the way direction that they were hunting or how they were hunting. So I'd seen it on several occasions, especially up in New Mexico, big open country, two coyotes hunting down a wash, and one would get the other one's attention, and you could tell the other one, you know, had heard it and would stare at him for a minute, and then twist his head back and forth, and then they would change the direction they were going. And I said, I'm close enough, I should be able to hear something. What they were doing was whining at a frequency that was above what a human can hear. In other words, they were communicating ultrasonically, and everybody has heard or seen the silent dog whistles.
Yep.
All we hear as humans is air going through that whistle, yet your dog can hear it. Same was true with what we have found out is the human can hear to about 20,000 hertz. Hertz is the way that you measure sound frequencies. And we can hear, when we were young, before all this heard all this gunfire,
right,
I could hear it about 20,000 hertz. Well, a coyote or a canine hears to 45,000 hertz. And a feline, a bobcat, can hear to 65,000 hertz. So that's what I talk about, ultrasonics. I'm talking about those sounds that are above what we can hear, and that coyotes communicate in those tones, and also, and of course, cats can communicate in those tones as well. One time I was sitting on an oat field and down in below Dilly, Texas, hunting for a big old mature 8-point deer. Right about sundown, about a half-grown bobcat walks out and sits down in the brush line. And so he sits there for a few minutes, and then all of a sudden he breaks and goes running across the corner of the field. There was no sound. When he gets about halfway through the field, I hear, in the direction he's going, a fawn in distress. And that's a sound that's a bleating sound that I've heard many times, because it's a sound I use to call predators. I've got it recorded, and then I mimic it on hand calls. Well, how did that kitten know that its mother was about to catch that deer? There was, like I say, it was dead calm that evening. There was no sound. Evidently, she had communicated somehow with that kitten, and here he goes racing to her before she catches the deer. So I'm going, there's something to this ultrasonic stuff. So then I started, studying it. And then I started looking for speakers, find a way to reproduce those sounds. And, of course, about 5 years ago, I found some speakers that would go ultrasonic. So Then I thought, well, okay, we'll just record you know, the sounds I've got, they'll work. No, we had to build a speaker that would record ultrasonics, because if that sound is not recorded ultrasonically, it could never be, it can never produce ultrasonics.
Sure.
So that's what we did. We went out and started re-recording all of our sounds, and of course built a player that will reproduce those sounds and hit those high frequencies. And in order to do that, in order to get all the true range of the sounds that those animals produce, we had to use two speakers. You have to have a speaker that'll handle the low frequencies, and then you have to have the ultrasonic speaker, which handles those frequencies above what we can hear. And then they have to work in unison. So this was a pretty complicated project. In fact, very complicated. It had never been done before. And we've been using prototypes for about the last 2 years. And what we're seeing is our calling success is greatly increased. And the thing that I think is most important is we can go back into country that we've hunted hard in the past, or where somebody else has called hard in the past and educated those predators. A coyote educates real quick to the old calls, because they're not producing those true sounds. So the first time you go into, say, that ranch and play with our old electronics, it worked really well. But the second time you went in there, and the third time, you would notice your success rate would drop rapidly. But now with being able to go in with the new technology, we find that our success stays much above average. And also animals are responding. Not only coyotes are coming more aggressively, they're coming more comfortably. In other words, when they get to the sound, it seems like they're more relaxed. We're not producing that artificial sound. And there would be no need for this call if, say, the distress sounds we're using for calling weren't going ultrasonic. But so far, every sound that we have recorded and tested by playing it on an oscilloscope has gone over 40,000 hertz. Hmm.
So is that the proof? Because I'm a little skeptical, because how do I know your machine is producing ultrasonic sound if I can't hear it? But I guess you're saying
you're
the proof
exactly
is in the pudding.
Right. The only way to do it is to play it on an oscilloscope, or you can. I've got a laptop here that I've downloaded what they call a bat recorder app, where bats not only communicate ultrasonically, they use it to fly basically as radar. Mm-hmm. And so I have an ultrasonic mic that we can play the sound into, and using that app on a laptop, I can analyze that sound. I can tell you to what frequency it goes to.
That's crazy. Yeah, you don't think about all the to your point, you don't think about all the technology and thought and engineering and reverse engineering that's to go into creating these calls. You have to come up with something to record them and to play them on both sides. And you guys have done a phenomenal job over the years advancing that technology. So without divulging any trade secrets, what's the next big thing for you guys?
Well, the next big thing is being able to get it built.
Okay.
You know, we placed a PO for 3,000 units. And as you know, getting your hands on semiconductors right now is impossible. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Try to go buy, you know, a new pickup.
Yeah.
And so we're in the same boat as, we're not the big fish like Ford Motor Company, but we have the same problem they do right now. You know, we're trying to get the components to build this product so we can get it out on the market. And right now we just can't get it done. But we're told here in a month or two, they feel like, you know, that's going to loosen up a little bit, and hopefully, and I hope they do, because I've been working on this project for 4 years, money's been going one direction.
Yep. Yeah.
I'm ready to see a return on this.
It's about time to reverse the tide on this one. All right, folks, we're joined today by Gary Robinson. Gary is the owner of Burnham Brothers Game Calls and host of Carnivore TV. We're going to take a quick break here on Hunting Matters on KPRC 950.
By the way they held their eyes, so if you don't mind my saying, I can see you're out of aces for a taste of your whiskey. You say you were wrong to ever leave me alone, and now you're sorry, you're lonesome and scared. And you say you'd be happy if you could just come back home. Well, here's a quarter, call someone who cares.
Good morning. Welcome back to Hunting Matters on KPRC. I'm your host, Joe Bitar.
I am Ramon Robles.
We are joined today by Gary Robertson. Gary is the owner of Burnham Brothers Game Calls. Check out the cool stuff that they've got. We've been talking about it over at burnhambrothers.com. That's burnhambrothers.com.
Well, I'm a little disappointed. We're three quarters of the way through
with
the show.
With me or with
Gary?
Well,
with the show.
The whole show.
Gary, okay. You, just about everybody.
We're just all disappointments in your life,
yeah,
aren't we?
Well, because we've gone this far and yep. We haven't to do a call yet.
Ooh.
Now, you guys who hunt all the time are used to this. You don't, it's no big deal to hear a call. Yeah. For me.
Well, I can do a call for you.
Ka-ka! Ka-ka! Gary, is there anything... my God. Is there anything you can produce right now to make a call?
Yes, I'll step back here and grab one of my old pets.
See?
Old Pets, that's the name of my new band.
This was a call I came out with in about 20 years ago.
Okay.
And I call it the Mini Blaster. And because it's very small, but it doesn't take a lot of wind to blow it, and it hits. I tested it on the oscilloscope just to see what frequency it went to.
Okay.
And it goes high 40s, 45 to 50,000 hertz.
Wow.
Which I always wondered why this call was always. Seemed to be very effective, and I think that's why it hits those
frequencies up there.
that are sweet to a coyote or a cat.
Yeah.
So here's kind of what it sounds like.
All right. Wow. Now what is that mimicking?
Was that loud enough?
That was yep. loud. Now what's that mimicking?
Just kind of like a cottontail distress.
Okay.
I make it maybe a little gravelier where it sounds a little jackrabbity, but it doesn't make that much difference. What you want to do is make a distress sound.
Yeah.
And you could take this call the very first time, go out in the field and probably have as much success calling as I do. Just because you don't sound like I do, these rabbits don't sound like each other.
Okay.
You know, they don't go out there and practice distress sounds.
Hey, Timmy, you step on me this time.
when you blow it, you might sound more like a deer distress.
Right. Yeah.
But it doesn't make any difference. A coyote is opportunistic. Mm-hmm. A bobcat's opportunistic. They're going to come to either... whether you're blowing the call or I'm blowing the call.
Okay.
You know, Ramon, that call kind of reminded me of the sound you make when you show up at the coffee pot.
Well,
empty.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
that same kind of whining sound. Hey, Gary, before I forget, now, you wrote a book, Eyes Front, 60 Years of Hunting the Hunters. Tell us about mm-hmm. that.
My wife, Deb, that you know well,
yep.
had been after me for several years to write a book. And I was always like, yeah. You know, we'll do it one of these days. Mm-hmm. We'll do it one of these days. I kept kicking that can down the road. And one day, out of the blue, a fellow friend of mine walked in here. And he had worked for several newspapers around the state and gotten into the publishing business. And so I thought he was out living in Midland, working in the oil company. And he said, oh, no, I'm at Midland all right, but I have a publishing business. Well, Deb heard that, and here she comes. She said that we've been wanting to do a book, and we just, you know, wanted somebody to publish it.
And you said, what's this
we
thing?
Can you do that? So here we go. She said, of course, you know, that was, you know, God telling us that we need to do it. And so here we went. So it was right after COVID hit, and we just, you know, everything was slow. And I said, well, maybe this is a good time to do it. So we did a year-long project in about 3 months. And I think we released that book in August of last year.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been popular, kind of crazy. But it's a compilation of stories all having to do pretty much with hunting, but most important, of calling, because that's, to me, that's what makes hunting, gives you hunting another dimension. If I can rattle that whitetail to me, that's more exciting than sitting in a blind and looking at a feeder.
Right.
And then there's 8 chapters that are kind of how to on rattling whitetails. Then there's about 10 chapters on calling turkeys. I did a lot of that at one time.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, I used to hunt every single day of the season, of the spring season. I didn't care about hunting them in the fall. I enjoyed calling them. And I loved to watch a gobbler come in strutting and making a fool of himself. And so there's 10 chapters on calling turkeys. And then the rest of the book is devoted to predators, which is, you know, my love and something that any of us can do year round. And there's no bag limits. So,
right.
We did a lot of it's how to, and the last chapter is devoted totally to ultrasonics and explaining, you know, what we are talking about when we say ultrasonics and what animals hear. So, like I say, it's been successful. Kind of shocks me that people actually are interested in that sort of stuff.
No, yeah, I mean you provide you've got a wealth of information and experience in that field. So I can't think of somebody better to write the book. I'm glad Deb made you do it. How can people find it and buy it?
Oh, they can just go to our website. Just go to burnhambrothers.com.
Okay.
And that's the easiest way. And if they'll give us some instructions, we'll autograph a copy for them, and,
cool.
And which will really hurt the value of the book. but I will market it if you want me to.
There you go. Hey, listen, we could talk I could do a whole hour on tips and techniques with you, but a couple of things before we wrap up here in a couple of minutes. You taught me a long time ago, we were out in West Texas, south of Marfa, and you said to me, hey, you need to start looking up at the sky and be a bird watcher whenever you're calling predators. Can you explain kind of briefly what that means to our listening audience, Gary?
Sure. Anytime I'm calling, I like what I call air support, and that is, birds, it's generally birds of prey. And so if you're calling in West Texas or South Texas, Harris's hawks, caracaras, those are animals that'll come to a call. And if they fly in there and they don't say anything, chances are they're not seeing a predator either. But I promise you, if that Harris's hawk or red-tailed hawk sees a predator, bobcat or coyote, coming to the call, they're going to start squealing. So that gives you warning that, hey, something is there. And if I'm calling in the panhandle, it may be crows. If I'm in New Mexico, it's ravens. If I go further north, it may be magpies. But those birds will follow those predators to a call, and they generally get vocal when that predator is close to you. So I love it. I mean, if they give me an eye in the sky, and like I say, if I'm kind of dozing off, it's been a slow day, and that hawk flies in and goes to squealing, he's going to wake me up because I know something's there.
Yeah, that was something I never learned, never been taught before, never even considered. And you know, Gary's sitting beside me, Ramon. We're out in this in this field, and he's like, there's a coyote out there, and I couldn't see him. He said, look up, and there was a hawk flying over, and we knew it was there. So, well, Gary, listen, man, we got to have you back on and talk for a whole hour just on tips and secrets. But thank you so much for joining us, folks. Joining us today has been Gary Roberson. Gary is the owner of Burnham Brothers. Go to burnhambrothers.com. That's burnhambrothers.com. And check them out at Carnivore TV or Pursuit Channel. We'll be back next week with Hunting Matters on KPRC 950. Back in the wood, you see, a woman and a kid.